Greet the person to your right or to your left and say, there's a word that's going to stir you up today. Tell them there's a word that's going to stir you up today. You're going to be stirred up, I believe, by the word of God. I want to welcome all those who are joining us via live stream. God bless you. We truly thank you for your online presence. And I want to encourage you who are watching online right now to block out every distraction, every hindrance that will hinder the word from gaining lodgment, because the Holy Spirit is going to speak profound things to you as well. And so we thank you so much for your online presence as we prepare to jump into the word. We're starting or kicking off a new segment of our series this morning entitled Penetrate. We have been talking about the kingdom of God for the last 2 years. We've been focusing on the kingdom. I do not see us slowing down anytime soon, so you might want to just settle in the fact that we're going to be on the kingdom for quite some time, everything coming back to the kingdom. And it's brought us into a point of a segment entitled Penetrate. If you're taking notes, I want you to write down the title or the theme of today's message, which is a call to anguish. A call to anguish, if you're taking notes. And for those of you who are taking notes, I want you to simply write down the word kingdom. And when I say the word kingdom, next to that word, I want you to write down how you see the kingdom. What is your perspective of the kingdom? And the reason why I want you to write that down is because you function and live out of your perspective. And the way you see the kingdom is going to have an impact on how you operate in the kingdom. So don't worry about your neighbor seeing your thoughts about the kingdom. I want you to keep that as a reference point, because I believe that during this continuation of series of teaching, that definition that you define today is going to expand as we go throughout these series of teachings. The kingdom. When you look at the assignment of every kingdom, its purpose, and you have to understand this, the purpose of the kingdom is to expand. Every king has one goal in mind. You have to hear this. It's to take territory. That's his purpose. And when you look at some of the greatest empires that the world has ever seen, if you look at the Roman Empire, by Caesar Augustus, we see the expansion of the Roman Empire, where they were able to, at their prime, cover 20% of the earth in its control and authority. They governed 20% of the earth's population in its prime. They reached control throughout all of the Mediterranean, throughout parts of Asia, throughout parts of Africa, throughout parts of modern-day Europe. They gained mastery and control. You move forward in time, we just celebrated the homegoing of the Queen of England. Some celebrate her, some do not. If you study out history, there may be some controversial things in the lineage of her family. When you look at Great Britain and their expansion, at Great Britain's peak, they mastered to govern 25% of the world's population. Their influence expanded throughout the continent of Africa. It expanded throughout Australia. Their influence expanded throughout the Americas. It expanded throughout Australia, different parts of the world. They were able to conquer 25% of the world's population. And though many will criticize things in her history and in her family's history, but they're not seeing it from a kingdom perspective. Because the goal of the kingdom is to take territory. Because once the territory is conquered, now that territory is infused with your ideology and your doctrine. Now we see that from a natural point of view, but spiritually, when Jesus came, he had the same concept in mind. That Jesus didn't just come to bring you into salvation so that your eternal life is secure. This is why when you read throughout the book of Acts chapter 1, the Bible says that after he was raised from the grave, he spent 40 days here on earth teaching of things pertaining to what? The kingdom. When Jesus released his disciples to go and preach the gospel, he did not instruct them to go preach faith. He did not instruct them to go preach grace. He didn't instruct them to go preach hope. He didn't instruct them to go preach love. He gave them a simple instruction, go preach the kingdom. Because in the mind of God, you have to see this, God is territorial. And according to Colossians chapter 1, verse number 13, please throw that on the screen. Colossians chapter 1, verse number 13, when you were born again, please put that on the screen. Colossians 1, verse number 13. Says this, he has delivered us from the power of darkness. This is what happened when you received Jesus Christ. You were delivered from the power of darkness. And conveyed, that word conveyed simply means to be transferred into. Because the only way to inherit the kingdom, hear me, is that it must be inherited. We just saw King Charles come into authority. They didn't have to go into a boardroom and to debate who was going to receive the inheritance, who was going to receive power, who was going to be next in command. The command always transfers to whoever has the inherited right. And the only way you could come into the kingdom was through the blood of Jesus Christ, which gives you now the inherited right to be rendered and operated from the powers of darkness and conveyed or transferred now into the kingdom of God. So you, when you accepted Christ, you did not come into religion. You did not come into Christianity, because when you study out even the phrase Christianity, it was a label placed by King Agrippa in the book of Acts as a mocking term. Jesus never died for you to become a Christian. He died for you to become a partner in his kingdom. You are engrafted into a kingdom. And his kingdom is no different than the ideology of any other king that lives. The King of England, his goal is not just to make better laws. Their goal is how can we expand this vision around the world? Right now, if we are citizens, many of us are citizens of the United States of America. We did not go into Iraq because people were hurting. How do we know that? Because there are several places in the world where people are hurting, but we didn't go. We went as an opportunity to establish and to expand what? Our kingdom. So we fought in a foreign land for nearly more than a decade to establish democracy. A lot of times, think about this. How is it?
I shouldn't even be talking about this, but we're here, so we might as well.
When you look at the news, there's a lot of things the nation doesn't have money for. We don't have money to feed people. We don't have the money to support different programs. Where is the funding going to come from to have daycares? You see the fight between the Republican and the Democrat. The Democratic Party typically wants to help the people. The Republican Party, for the most part, there's a war on how to help the people. But there's a shortage of money. But have you ever noticed when global crisis hits, we find billions of dollars? So Russia went to war with Ukraine. Now, here's what's amazing. Because many Americans took a position to say, I stand with Ukraine. Russia is the bad guy. Many of us have seen this in the news headlines. But what's interesting is this. Were we not Russia when we went into Iraq? Did we not go in on false intel? So we find billions of dollars to fund, because it's not about just helping my brother, it's about establishing
influence. Because every kingdom is focused on one assignment: to expand. And for some of you, the reason why you experience the warfare you experience when you connect to kingdom things is because you have now attached to something that God has caused to expand in the earth, and the gates of hell will always war against whatever will expand God's kingdom. So the warfare that many of you are experiencing is not because you're white, it's not because you're black, it's not because you're rich, it's not because you're poor, it's not because you live in the city of Akron. The warfare is to stop you and your assignment that God has called you to expand his kingdom. This is why things, it's not a coincidence. As soon as I get going, things pop up to get you to take a step back from expanding the kingdom. Because the assignment of the kingdom is to expand. Because here's the end goal according to Revelation chapter 5. You can study this out in your own time. Here's where this is all going. The end goal is that the kingdom of God will be set up here. According to Revelation chapter 5, he has made us kings and priests, and as kings and priests, we shall rule on the earth forever. That's Revelation chapter 5. That's the end goal. So our assignment is to go take the kingdoms of this world, according to, I believe, Revelation chapter 15 or 11. We go and take the kingdoms of this world to bring them now into the kingdoms of our God. We take the kingdoms and bring them into the kingdom. Because the end result is that his kingdom is eventually going to reign here. This is why when Jesus spent time ministering, he said, go preach the kingdom. And what's unfortunate is that we live in a modernized church that can preach you to church politics, and we can tell you about great cliches, but we are void of the revelation of the kingdom. How do we know this is true? Because when we went through one of the greatest pandemics that we had ever seen in our lifetime, we were labeled non-essential. You know what non-essential means? I can function without you. So we've been labeled. Government can function without us. The educational system can function without us. The economic structures can function without us. And you know what's sad? This is the sad part. It's true. And I don't know about you, but there's a blood boiling inside of me that I'm disappointed that is true. I'm not talking about we can't pray and what we're resisting in the realm of the spirit and our position to hold up and resist things. I'm not talking about that spiritual position. I'm talking about from a natural point of view. Because we have not established presence. I didn't say we didn't build churches. And I didn't say we didn't have a good shelter to feed people in the clothing. I didn't say that, because when it came time for the rubber to meet the road, that wasn't essential. We didn't have a voice in the room. And believers around the world, that something should be stirring up inside of us to take our voice back. Because the kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violent take it by force, and there is territory that God has assigned for you and I to take. Amen. Amen. We're just talking a little bit this morning. Run to Matthew real quick. I'm not going to be before you long, because we're just setting the stage of where we're about to go in this series of teaching. Today we're just getting a taste. You know how you walk through Sam's Club and they just give you a little taste? You know, we're just getting a little taste of the guacamole this morning. Just a little taste, you know, that cinnamon butter that they sell. We're just getting a little taste this morning where we're going. Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16. And we're going to pick up at Matthew 16, 18. You can write that down in your notes because we'll paraphrase that in a moment. But for some of you who are students of the Word, I want you to have that reference of Scripture as well when you spend time in devotion this week. Matthew 28, verse number 16. It says, then the 11 disciples went away to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. Let's keep going, verse number 17. It says, when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Verse 18. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Verse number 19. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now, who's speaking here is Jesus. This is known for some who are theologians or Bible students. This is known as what is called the Great Commission. It's the Great Commission, and this commission is not just a commission to bishops. It's not just a commission to pastors. It is not just a commission to evangelists, to apostles. It is not just a commission to people who are called to ministry school. This is a commission to everybody who has been transferred out of darkness into light. This is the Great Commission to go into all the world. You see the kingdom viewpoint. And I even notice here as a ministry, there's always been a resistance to go beyond, to keep it contained. And for some of you, there's been a warfare to keep you contained because you're not to be contained, but you're to be expanded. This is why God has given you a spirit of faith to go from faith to faith, not to be contained where you are, but to expand from where you are. So he gives the Great Commission to go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations, to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. When I look at this Great Commission, I question, where are we? See, this series of teaching is not about you getting a breakthrough. It's not about a car. It's not about a house. So I don't know if you want to rock with me because we're getting ready to get into the gospel. And I realize the modern 2022 gospel is a bless me message. I do realize that the modern gospel is about what you can get from God instead of building real relationship with God. I know that those are things that help build the now church, but the bad part about that is when the storms, the floods, and the winds come knock on your life's door, you can't stand on a bless me message. You need the real authenticity of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So if you're looking for a bless me message, I'm probably not going to be the pastor for you for the next few weeks. I'm just letting you know right now because we're getting into what's called the gospel. So he says, do this. He says, go into all the world. That word go implies penetrate. Now, you don't need to penetrate if there's not a resistance to get into it. Understand that? If there wasn't a resistance to get into it, you can just walk into it. But he's letting you know there's going to be resistance. Right. To penetrate into all the world. Amen. Go penetrate. Amen. You know, it's interesting when I look at the news and the modern world that we live in, there's a particular group that I think has been doing a great job of penetrating. Now, I don't agree with their ideology. I don't agree with their doctrine. But they're doing a great job. And it might be something that the church can maybe, instead of condemning them, we will always love them, but maybe the church can maybe look at them as maybe a reference point to say, hey, you kind of got something going on over there, and that would have to be the LGBTQ community. I am not, before I say what I'm going to say, I'm not endorsing that community. I am not agreeing with that community. My agreement and allegiance is not to a party. It's with God's word. Amen. Okay? Amen. But despite that, we will still walk in love. So it's not an endorsement message, but it is a message to look at the reality that they're penetrating.
Yes, they are.
Because when you look at every facet, just look at the education industry. They have penetrated the education community so much, so, that now some of your 4, 5, 6, 7-year-old children are being induced with the knowledge of same-sex practice. Now in sex ed, they teach around age 10, 11, they teach how to practice safe same sex. It's part of their curriculum. So they've gotten Bibles out of school and have gotten same sex into school because they found out how to penetrate. Let's look at the political arena. Because you find more and more those who are in political office practice this lifestyle. And because they practice this lifestyle, they put laws into place that endorse what we label equality. And they have found out how to create laws to benefit their movement. So much so to the point that if you speak against them from a political infrastructure, they're so powerful now you get canceled. This is the world we live in. I'm just reporting the news right now. Let's go to the military. That was the debate, a topic in which our former president, President Trump, kind of took a position against, was trying to reverse it. But nevertheless, they have made progress to see that those who practice that lifestyle can be included. They're penetrating. Go to the entertainment sector. You turn on your television, you will see this practice just to sell a bottle of Coke. Years ago, it was something just to see a man and a woman to engage physically on television. Now, almost in every sector or influence, you see this practice taking place. Even so much to the point now, even within our cartoons. Why does an animal have to be homosexual in a cartoon? And the church has taken a position where we just go pray against it. Should start with prayer. The Bible says his house shall be a house of prayer. But we're not just called to have prayer, we're called to penetrate. And the reason why these things are happening is because as a church, the body of Christ, the ecclesia, the called out, we're not penetrating. See, in the book of Matthew chapter 16, verse number 18, Jesus says something profound when he is en route to what is called Caesarea of Philippi. Caesarea Philippi was one of the longest journeys that Jesus went on to go minister. And what you find is that Caesarea Philippi was a modern-day Las Vegas. So any and everything goes. This is why some people say, what happens in Vegas, what stays in Vegas. And some of you done been to Vegas, and you know what I'm talking about. But that was what Caesarea Philippi was like in that day and age. It was a modern-day Las Vegas. So Jesus is on his way there, which testifies to me of the heart of Jesus, because they had a purity system. You know how in our culture we have an economic system which really brings divide? Racism is really financial divide. Really, that's what it is. It's not skin color. It's really an economic divide. Because if you have that economy, trust me, they will welcome you with open arms despite what color you are. It's economic at the end of the day. But what you find is that Jesus, despite this purity system, we're divided by money, they were divided by purity. So the impure did not connect with the pure. The bottom line, there's no way somebody that is pure is going to go on a journey to go minister to somebody who is impure, which testifies to the love of Jesus. So Jesus goes to Caesarea Philippi, and while he's on his way to Caesarea Philippi, he stops and has a conversation with the disciples. Many of you know the story. And he begins to ask them, he says, who do men say that I am? And of course they say, well, some say you're John the Baptist, some say you're this, some say you're a prophet. And Jesus says, but who do you say that I am?
And so Peter now has what? A revelation. Peter says, you are the Son of the living God. And so Jesus in return implies and says this. He says, flesh and blood could not have revealed this to you, Peter. This had to be divine by the Spirit of God for you to see who I am. They had a moment of intimacy, and this is what makes worship, sidebar, this is what makes worship so powerful, is because worship is an opportunity for you to engage in intimacy with God. Why is intimacy so powerful? Because it's an intimacy that you can see God, and it's an intimacy that you can really see you. I want to encourage some of you, hear me. When you are in a dry place, you got to get into worship. When you are in a blah place, you got to get into worship. When you are in a place where I don't know what to do and I'm so confused, you got to press to get into worship, because worship is an environment where you can get your vision back because you're engaging in intimacy with God. So they have this intimacy, this moment of intimacy. And Jesus says something profound. He says, upon this rock of revelation. The revelation wasn't Peter. The revelation was the rock was the revelation Peter had. And what was that revelation? The revelation, he was the Son of the living God. And so he says, upon that revelation, we're going to now build the church. But hear me. He says we're going to build the church. He wasn't talking about just the four-wall structure. And he wasn't talking about this ideology, well, I am the church, so I can just kind of do what I want to do. He wasn't talking about that either. Because the church, that was not a foreign term. When he says church, ecclesia, that word would be ecclesia. When I looked that up in the Greek, ecclesia means what? A called out. And at that time, there were churches. People were called to certain sectors, but Jesus is saying now we're about to branch off into a whole new sector, and upon this revelation, we're going to build now the church or the kingdom, because the kingdom, it wasn't about just your religious ideology, but the ecclesia, the church, was about the assignment of impacting political systems, governmental systems, military systems, financial systems. And what Jesus is communicating upon this rock of revelation, we're now going to start building and expanding the kingdom. Oh, amen. If you're not getting anything out of this, I pray your mind is expanding to the fact that when you accepted Christ, it was bigger than just your receipt to go to heaven, but it's the fact that God wants to use you in the earth to expand his vision. That's what he wants to use you for. So he says, what? Upon this rock of revelation, I will build my church. I'm going to build my ecclesia. I'm going to build my called out. And I was studying this week and looking at some of the realities of the Western church. That's us, y'all. That's us. It's our time now. This is our watch. And I want to look at the report of what's happening. This ain't on the bishop's watch. This ain't on the pastor. This is your watch. This is your hour. What's happening right now? I'm going to give you some statistics of what's happening right now. Watch this, on our watch. Doing our leg. You got to hear me. This is our leg of the race. The baton has been passed to all of us. What's happening in our leg of the race? Let's take a look statistically. Statistically, in the 1980s, 90% of Americans labeled themselves to be followers of the Christian faith. In the 80s, I'm an 80s baby. That ain't that long ago, 90%. By 2011, that number went from 90% to 75%. And from 2011 to 2021, that number has now dwindled down to 63%. That's almost a 30% drop in 30 years. We're losing on the average of 10% a year. Oh, but we had church. Oh, the glory was in the house. The preacher can preach. We just built a new gymnasium. Woohoo! 63%. 30 years ago, over 90%. We've lost 30% to the Christian faith in 30 years.
from the 1940s up until the early 2000s. That's 60 plus years. Early 2000s. Hear me. 75% of Christians were committed to a church. From the 40s to the 2000s. Over 60 years. But between 2000 and 2022, 20 years, that number is now down to 43%. That's almost half. And what we're seeing is that there's been an increase in the agnostic. There's now an increase in the Unitarianism. We're finding an increase in Islam. So much to the point, I want to read this fact to you that was, I found it by way of research from the Pew Research Center, which is the future world of religion. I took out a segment of this article, and it says, over the next three decades, Christians, however, will remain the largest religious group in the world, but Islam is growing at such a rapid rate that by 2050, it will be equal to Christians around the world and on pace to eventually surpass it. This is our watch. We've seen the labor of the forefathers that went before us begin to regress. Watch this. This is your watch. It's not the preacher. The commission wasn't to preachers. The commission was for everybody who signed up to be a follower of Jesus. Something is happening. And part of what's happening is that the gospel is not only not being preached, but the gospel is not being practiced. There's a clip I want you to hear right now. Media team, please tell me. Listen, I'm down on bended knee, man. You know how the song goes. I'm down on bended knee. Please tell me that this clip is going to work. Please, baby. Please tell me it's going to work. I know I was a little dramatic, but that's how important this clip is right now that we're about to play. I want you to play that clip. Please give volume, please.
And I look at the whole religious scene today, and all I see are the inventions and ministries of man and flesh. It's mostly powerless. It has no impact on the world.
Please turn the volume levels for that up. Thank you.
And I look at the whole religious scene today, and all I see are the inventions and ministries of man and flesh. It's mostly powerless. It has no impact on the world. And I see more of the world coming into the church and impacting the church rather than the church impacting the world. I see the music taking over the house of God. I see entertainment taking over the house of God. An obsession with entertainment in God's house, a hatred of correction and a hatred of reproof. Nobody wants to hear it anymore. Whatever happened to anguish in the house of God? Whatever happened to anguish in the ministry? It's a word you don't hear in this pampered age. You don't hear it. Anguish means extreme pain and distress. The emotion so stirred that it becomes painful. Acute, deeply felt inner pain because of conditions about you, in you or around you. Anguish. Deep pain, the sorrow, agony of God's heart. We've held on to our religious rhetoric and our revival talk, but we've become so passive. All true passion is born out of anguish. All true passion for Christ comes out of a baptism of anguish. You search the scripture and you'll find that when God determined to recover a ruined situation, He would share His own anguish for what God saw happening to His church and to His people. And He would find a praying man and He would take that man and literally baptize him in anguish. You find it in the book of Nehemiah. Jerusalem is in ruins. How is God going to deal with this? How is God going to restore the ruin? Now folks, look at me. Nehemiah was not a preacher. He was a career man. But this was a praying man. And God found a man who would not just have a flash of emotion, not just some great sudden burst of concern and then let it die. He said, no, I broke down and I wept and I mourned and I fasted. And then I began to pray night and day. Why didn't these other men, why didn't they have an answer? Why didn't God use them in restoration? Why didn't they have a word? Because there was no sign of anguish. No weeping. Not a word of prayer. It's all ruin. Does it matter to you today? Does it matter to you at all that God's spiritual Jerusalem, the church, is now married to the world? That there's such a coldness sweeping the land? Closer than that, does it matter about the Jerusalem that's in our own hearts? The sign of ruin that's slowly draining spiritual power and passion, blind to lukewarmness, blind to the mixture that's creeping in. That's all the devil wants to do, is get the fight out of you and kill it. So you won't labor in prayer anymore. You won't weep before God anymore. You can sit and watch television and your family go to hell. Let me ask you, is what I just said convicted you at all? There's a great difference between anguish and concern. Concern is something that biggest interests you. You take an interest in a project or a cause or a concern or a need. And I want to tell you something I've learned over all my years, 50 years of preaching. If it is not born in anguish, if it has not been born by the Holy Spirit, where when you saw and heard of the ruin, that drove you to your knees, took you down into a baptism of anguish where you began to pray and seek God. I know now. Oh my God, do I know it. Until I'm in agony. Until I have been anguished over it. And all our projects, all our ministries, everything we do. Where are the Sunday school teachers that weep over kids they know are not hearing and they're going to hell? You see, a true prayer life begins at the place of anguish. You see, if you set your heart to pray, God's going to come and start sharing your heart, His heart with you. Your heart begins to cry out, oh God, your name is being blasphemed. The Holy Spirit's being mocked. The enemy is out trying to destroy the testimony of the Lord's faithfulness, and something has to be done. There's going to be no renewal, no revival, no awakening until we're willing to let Him once again break us. Folks, it's getting late and it's getting serious. Please don't tell me you're concerned when you're spending hours in front of internet or television. Come on. Lord, there's somebody to get this altar and confess. I am not what I was. I am not where I'm supposed to be. God, I don't have your heart or your burden. I wanted it easy. I didn't want to be happy. But Lord, true joy comes. True joy comes out of anguish. There's nothing of the flesh will give you joy. I don't care how much money, I don't care what kind of new house there is, absolutely nothing physical can give you joy. It's only what is accomplished by the Holy Spirit when you obey Him and take on His heart. Build the walls around your family. Build the walls around your own heart. make you strong and impregnable against the enemy. God, that's what we desire.
Church, we're going to stop right here this morning. But I gave you a lot of facts to support my argument. That as the body, we're regressing. As a body, we're becoming more and more like the world. As the body, we're becoming less spiritual. As the body, we're becoming less concerned. What matters to the hearts of God. And that's people, and that's the progression of the kingdom. And we're living in an hour where it's not just the preacher's job. He's not just calling the preacher. God is calling you. What are you going to do about this? What are you going to do about some of these statistics that I said, that I read to us this morning? Many who have gone before us were martyrs for the gospel. Laid it all down only to watch their investment regress. You may say, well, you know, I don't have much influence and I'm not this big bishop, and what am I supposed to do? Answer the call to prayer right where you are. Allow God to birth a burden inside of your heart, of a heart of anguish. A heart that says, God, whatever it costs, whatever it takes. See, in order to walk in this, what it means is that we got to put down this modern gospel that just has the mirror up to my face. I'm not happy, and I don't have this, and I want this, and I want my life like this, and I want, that was never the message of Jesus Christ. This is why Jesus said, listen, if you're going to follow me, foxes are going to have holes, but the Son of Man doesn't have a place to lay his head. He wasn't talking about his economic condition. He was talking about the reality. There's no space for me in this earth. And it cost me everything. And we are seeing families ruined, communities ruined. What is the church going to do? I'm not talking about giving away another basket of clothes. I'm not talking about us rising and giving away free food. Nothing wrong with that. But what I'm talking about is us taking a stand and being the difference. Willing to lay on our faces for children, lay on our faces for our families. Willing to lay our lives down to say, I'm going to be a living sacrifice for you, God. Wherever you want me to go, I'm willing to go. Whatever you want me to do, take this vessel of clay that you made, that I surrender my life to you. You can have it. See, this is what God is calling his people to in this hour. He needs people who are going to go for the gold. He needs people who are going to lay it all down for the gospel. See, God, none of that stuff matters anymore. I don't care about the money. I don't care about the houses. I don't care about the cars anymore. All I care about is seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. I'm trying to tell you, friend, when you start seeking the kingdom of God, all that stuff you're putting overtime in for, all that stuff you're fighting to get, all that stuff you're compromising the gospel for, God will add it to your life. So you got to trust him. He's a good father. He knows where you are. He knows what you need. But I believe the Spirit of God is calling us to balance these scales again. What do I mean by that? See, we built this imbalanced infrastructure where God is supposed to be the faithful one. God is supposed to supply. God is supposed to provide. God is supposed to be all these great things. And all we do is just receive. And I'm not talking about working to get, but what I'm talking about is that a covenant has balanced scales. And the balance of that scales is, God, whatever you want out of this life, this is a personal message. I don't want you thinking about nobody else. Where am I in anguish? Is there room in my heart
to burn for what your heart burns for? Is there space in my heart to lay myself down for what burdens your heart, God? If I were to do an altar call right now, and we were honest, I ain't talking about religious, but honest, there's not one person who would still be sitting in their seat. Because there's space in every man and woman's heart right now to step into what I'm talking about. Friend, these numbers that I read to you, these statistics that I read to you, this is real. And this is happening on our watch. But I believe that God, the Bible says, when the enemy comes in like the flood, that he's going to raise up the standard. The standard isn't in politics. The standard is you. The standard is me. The standard is your neighbor. God wants to raise you up to be a demonstrator of his kingdom, to draw people to the gospel. Think about it. When's the last time you personally told somebody about Jesus? When's the last time you picked up the phone and said, hey, I'm picking you up for service today. You got to go. See, if we're honest, we haven't made a call like that for some of us in years. For some of us, we ain't shared the gospel in decades. And the world is going right past us. God is calling us to penetrate, friend. And I believe in this hour and in this season that it's not just a revival, but I believe God is stirring up a revolution. Because a revival, hear me, revivals and reformations start at the top. But revolutions start at the bottom. And I believe God is pulling on hearts in this hour. He's touching on hearts in this season to say, I am done with some of the things that we've been seeing as a church. No longer having the image of entertainment and lacking the power of God. It's great to have lights. It's great to have LED screens. But where's the power? Where is the demonstration? Where are the signs? Where are the wonders? Where are the miracles? Where are the deliverances? Where's the manifestation of the presence of God? I believe there's a generation that's rising. I don't care how dope your platform is. And I don't care that the leader can sing great notes. We need somebody to usher us into the presence. There's a generation, I believe, of a remnant. That's crying out to say, I want something real. Amen. Amen. It's time for us to mobilize now more than ever before. Amen. You say, well, I don't have a platform. You got a platform in your home. You got a platform in your job. Social media has given you a platform to all your friends and all your followers. You got a platform. Amen. Start telling somebody about Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your grace. Lord, today is a message for us to gaze into the mirror. Lord, we don't want to glance by the mirror. We want to gaze. Because when we gaze, we get to see the beauty. But we also get to see the imperfections. And I think that every heart that's here who says, you know what, I want their space in me for the anguish. For every heart that's here today and say, you know what, I'm not where I need to be in God. I'm not doing what I know God's called me to do. I've allowed circumstances. I've allowed life. I've allowed family. I've allowed my job. I've allowed relationships. I've allowed all these things to intervene to take the place of what I know I'm supposed to be. What I'm supposed to be doing. I've allowed so many things to distract my attention. But I thank you, Lord God, by your spirit, that there's a fire being ignited. Lord, that we may see you in the beauty of your splendor. That God, you laid it all on the line when you sent Jesus. And when Jesus came, he laid it all on the line for us. And Father, we could never repay you. But what we can do is match your sacrifice.
And I thank you that there are hearts here this morning who say, God, I want to match your sacrifice. And as the scripture rings out, then the prophet Isaiah, who will go for us? That there's an us that God has called you to go for. And I know at times it's not fair, and I know at times it's not easy. But God needs somebody to stand in the gap. And Father, I thank you that in this moment, Lord, that you're ministering to everybody's heart that's here. Every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, those who are streaming over the internet, I thank you that you're visiting every heart to call us to feel that burden for the loss. Calls us to feel that burden. For some it may be children, for some it may be young men, for some it may be young women. For some it may be families, for some it may be in the Department of Education, in the financial sector. Calls us to feel that burden, Father. And allow that burden to turn into an anguish that motivates us not just to talk. Time is so intense right now that the days of talking are over, friend. The days of good church conversation, the days of one day, friend, that one day is today. That one day is this hour. That one day is this season. That one generation is this generation. Your Heavenly Father is counting on you to pick that assignment up. Whatever it is, you got to pick it up. Because statistically, we're regressing. But Lord, your grace is here today to anoint our eyes to see. And I thank that you spark a fire in us that cannot be shaken. You start a fire in us that will not be quenched, a fire that is ignited by the ministry of the Holy Spirit. That we will answer that call and we will go. Lord, we just love you so much.
Hello, this is Joshua Parker, and I want to say thank you for tuning into our message. I trust that the Word of God ministered life to you. I trust that you were encouraged by the good news of the gospel. You know, you may be listening and say, I've never made that confession of faith in Christ. I've never made that decision to make him my Lord and my Savior. Well, I want to give you the opportunity to do so today. I simply ask that you make this confession of faith with me and mean it from your heart. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I believe that you died and was raised from the grave that I might be justified. Today, I invite you into my heart, and I repent of sin knowingly and unknowingly. I thank you for becoming my Lord and becoming my Savior. And I thank you for filling me with the precious Holy Spirit that I may better know you and may better serve you. Friend, if you prayed that prayer, it's that simple, and you meant it in your heart, you're now part of the kingdom of God. Jesus Christ is now your Lord and your Savior. So I invite you and I welcome you into the kingdom. And also, you may desire more information about what just happened, more understanding about this spiritual transaction that just occurred in your life. Well, we invite you to go onto our webpage and simply on the main page, click on the link that is entitled Just Accepted Christ. You'll get more information. You can sign up for water baptism. You can receive more insight as to what happened in your life just right now. And we also say, hey, we invite you to connect with us. We have a text option on there where you can simply text us. You'll become a part of our messaging system where you'll get live and ministry updates. You'll receive videos. You'll receive live services directly to your phone or to your computer. And so we invite you to once again connect with us online. And also, if this ministry has been a blessing to you, if you've been receiving from the Word of God, then we invite you to sow into this work as well. The Bible says that when we receive spiritually, that we're to sow naturally. And so you may have been touched. The Word of God may be feeding you. This may be a feeding ground for you. Then I encourage you and invite you to become a partner with us by sowing physically into this ministry. You know, God is doing so many great things. He's given us a global mission and global assignment to take the gospel around the world, and your resources are making it happen. So I thank you so much for any present, past, or future gifts that you may sow into this work. God bless you. If this message has ministered life to you, please share it with someone. God bless you.